Okay, so we are going to read from Upadeshamrita, Nectar of Instruction. So text number 2. So very famous verse, I'm sure all of you have read it and many of you may have memorized it also. So let us chant together. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
Reading Nectar of Instruction, text 2. Atyaharah.
Atyaharah.
Prayasah.
Prayasah.
Cha. Prajalpah.
Prajalpah.
Niyama.
Niyama.
Agrahah.
Agrahah.
Janasangah.
Janasangah.
Cha. Laulyam.
Laulyam.
Cha. Sharbhihi.
Sharbhihi.
Bhaktihi.
Bhaktihi.
Vinashyati.
Vinashyati.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Prajalpo niyamagrahah.
Prajalpo niyamagrahah.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Sharbhir bhaktir vinashyati.
Sharbhir bhaktir vinashyati.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Prajalpo niyamagrahah.
Prajalpo niyamagrahah.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Sharbhir bhaktir vinashyati.
Sharbhir bhaktir vinashyati.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Prajalpo niyamagrahah.
Prajalpo niyamagrahah.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Sharbhir bhaktir vinashyati.
Sharbhir bhaktir vinashyati.
Atyahara prayasascha.
Atyahara prayasascha.
Prajalpa niyamagraha.
Prajalpa niyamagraha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Sharbhir
bhaktir vinashyati. Yes, some
more.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Atyaharah
prayasascha. Prajalpo niyamagraha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Sharbhir bhaktir vinashyati.
Sharbhir bhaktir vinashyati.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Prajalpo niyamagraha.
Prajalpo niyamagraha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Sharbhir bhakti vinashyati.
Sharbhir bhakti vinashyati. Matajis.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Prajalpo niyamagraha.
Prajalpo niyamagraha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Sharbhir bhakti vinashyati.
Sharbhir bhakti vinashyati.
Atyaharah prayasascha.
Atyaharah prayasascha. Prajalpo niyamagraha.
Prajalpo
niyamagraha. Janasangascha laulyam cha.
Janasangascha laulyam cha. Sadbhir bhaktir
Shardir Bhaktir Vinashyati.
Atyaharah Prayasascha.
Rajalpo Niyamagraha.
Jana Sangascha Lolyamcha.
Shardir Bhaktir Vinashyati.
Ati aharaha,
ati aharaha,
overeating,
overeating,
or too much collecting,
or too much collecting,
prayasaha,
prayasaha,
over endeavoring,
over endeavoring,
cha,
cha,
and prajalpaha,
prajalpaha,
idle talking,
idle talking,
niyama,
niyama,
rules and regulations,
rules and regulations,
agraha,
agraha,
too much attachment to,
too much attachment to,
or agraha,
agraha,
too much neglect of,
too much neglect of,
janasangraha,
janasangraha,
association with worldly minded persons,
cha,
and
laulyam,
ardent longing,
ardent longing,
or greed.
Cha,
and shadbhihi,
by these six,
bhaktihi,
devotional service,
vinashyati,
is destroyed.
Purport by translation by Srila Prabhupada. One's devotional service is spoiled when he becomes too entangled in the following six activities. 1. Eating more than necessary or collecting more funds than required. 2. Over endeavoring for mundane things that are very difficult to obtain. 3. Talking unnecessarily about mundane subject matters. 4. Practicing the scriptural rules and regulations only for the sake of following them and not for the sake of spiritual advancement. Or rejecting the rules and regulations of the scriptures and working independently or whimsically. 5. Associating with worldly minded persons who are not interested in Krishna consciousness. And 6. Being greedy for mundane achievements. The purport is very long, many pages long, so we will not read it, but we will refer to it bit by bit as we go along. Purport is 11 pages. Om Ajnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Kada Mahiyam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijala Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Te Bhakti Vedanta Swami Nitinamine Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharini Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarini Vancha Kalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Shri Advaita Gadadhara, Shivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So this book, Nectar of Instruction, is very important for us as practicing devotees. And I'm happy that we are discussing this book, or at least one verse of this book. And I'm happy that I'm back again in the house of Devesh and Vindarika and of course Sridhama and Sachi. Which is actually not their house, but it is the house of Sri Sri Gaur Nataraj, Nithai Gaur Nataraj. Correct?
Yes, trying to practice that.
So I'm happy to see all of you. I have met most of you earlier on one or more occasions. So happy to see all of you again here. This book is called Nectar of Instruction. The original name of this book is Upadesh Amrit. When you combine the two words, it is called Upadesh Amrit. The A at the end of Upadesh and the A in the beginning of Amrit combine to form a long A. So when you combine the two words, it becomes Upadesh Amrit. And we read the second verse in which we are given very important instructions about six things, shad bhihi. Shad means in Sanskrit six. So there are six things that are very harmful for our bhakti. Bhakti vinashyati. Vinashyati means destroys. So any devotee, any aspiring devotee, any practicing devotee must be very careful about these six points, because naturally we should try to do all those things that are favorable for our bhakti, our devotional service, and we should avoid all those things that are not favorable for our bhakti, that will harm our bhakti. So in this verse, the second verse, Srila Rupa Goswami, who is the author of this text, has given us six factors that are very harmful for our bhakti and that will destroy our bhakti. And in the next verse, text 3, he will mention six factors that are very good and very favorable for the growth of our bhakti. In that verse, third verse, he will say, Shadbhir Bhakti Prasiddhyati. But here it says, Shadbhir Bhakti Vinashyati, that which destroys bhakti. So therefore, we must pay very careful attention to these six points. You know, when we go to a doctor, the doctor usually gives us two types of instructions. What are the two types of instructions?
This has to take and this has to avoid.
Yes, do's and don'ts. Right? He will say, you do this, you do this, you do this, you take this medicine in such and such a way, you eat this, you do this exercise, you do this. He will give us many do's. But he will not leave it at that. He will also tell us many don'ts. Don't do this, don't do this, don't do this. Now, in general, we don't like to be told what to do and what to not do. Does anybody in this room like to be told?
No.
Do this, don't do this. Nobody likes it. This is the nature of the conditioned soul, that we are independent minded, we are conditioned by this world, we have a lot of ego. So whenever anyone tells us, do this, we say no. If you tell me, I won't do it. If somebody else says, we won't do. But if our mind says, then we say, okay, I want to do it. So one day I was talking to somebody and the person said, new person to devotional service. So the person said, I don't like to be told, you come in front of Krishna, then you have to bow down, or you have to chant so many rounds every day. When I feel like it, when my heart says, then I will do it. So this is very common. That when I feel like doing it, I will do it. But what is the answer you would give? If somebody says, you are trying to tell him, see, we are devotees, and you also try chanting Hare Krishna, we must also become devotee of Krishna. And suppose that person says, when I feel like it, I will do. But don't tell me do's and don'ts. If I feel like it, I will chant. If I feel like it, I will come to the temple. If I feel like it, I will read. But if I don't feel like it, then I will not do. Dil kahe to karenge. My heart says, I will do. So how would you reply to such a person? Because you will meet them. Many people of different kinds, different thoughts and opinions you will meet. So when you are trying to tell them, please chant, please read Bhagavad Gita, they will have many protests. Sometimes people may accept, like all of you accept it so nicely. But not everybody is like that. So some people will have so many objections. So how would you answer this person? You can raise your hand and try to tell me. Yes.
Out of duty, like it's our duty to thank God, and the duty has to be done punctually, sincerely. Like we go to office and do regularly, not like if I feel like going to office, I will go and I will come back. So we can't do that because we feel responsible. And out of duty, we go to office. It doesn't matter whether we like or not.
Okay, so your answer is that we should do it because it is a duty.
Yeah.
Just like we go to office as a sense of duty. Has it got disconnected? Hare Krishna. Okay, it's back there, no? So your answer is that we should do it because we are it out of a sense of duty, just like we go to office out of a sense of duty. So let me play the devil's advocate. You know what is the meaning of devil's advocate? That means deliberately I play the other side. So I am talking like the person who is doubting. Okay, so you are going to preach to me. So I am asking you. I say, I don't feel like chanting Hare Krishna. When I feel like, I will chant. So you tell me that it is like a duty. You must do the duty. So I say, no, I don't think it is my duty. When I feel like it's my duty, I will do it. So what will you answer? Yes.
You can see the person that you just try once. I mean, just try for a few days. If you don't feel any change, then don't do it. There's no harm in
it. Then after some days, I will come back and say, I tried for a few days, I don't feel like that. Then what will you say?
So,
I'm giving you very practical things because you are going to experience them. See, when you get something very nice in this world, don't keep it only to yourself. And you should teach your children also. When you get a nice thing, always share with others. Don't keep like this. Oh, this is for me. I won't share it, my toys or anything else, yes? Or if I get some nice mangoes or something, always share with others. So Krishna consciousness is the most precious thing we can ever get. The most valuable thing. So we must share it. But when you try to share it, there are people who don't want to receive it. What to do? But still, because our acharyas are telling us, you try to explain. So we try to explain. So then I say, well, I tried, I don't like it. Then what should we tell them?
So when we go to doctor, doctor gives us prescription saying, take this tablet 3 times a day. We can't say, you know, main dil se le lunga. Do din mein ek baar le lunga. Then you won't be getting cured, basically.
Right, correct. So we tell them that basically when you go to a doctor, then the doctor will give you do's and don'ts. At that time you cannot tell the doctor, when I feel like it, I will take the medicine. When I feel like it, I won't take it. when I feel like it, I will avoid the food you have asked me to avoid. But if I don't feel like it, I will take it. Then what will the doctor say? Then doctor will say, you will never become all right. Then the disease will continue. If you want to be cured of your disease, then you must follow the do's and don'ts very strictly. So you must be a good patient. But usually patients are most impatient. So they don't want to be patient with following the medicines and the instructions of the doctor. So similarly, we are materially diseased. When we go to a doctor, we may have some disease like bronchitis or some itis, something. We may have something. So we go. But what is our disease in the world? Actually, that is the root of all these diseases. It is the fact that we have material existence, that we have to take this body, because of which we get so many diseases, so much suffering, birth, death, old age, disease. So because of forgetfulness of Krishna, who is our origin and our source, we are forced to accept a material body. And then because of that, we suffer. The moment the material body comes in the picture, then there is suffering. So if you want to get rid of the suffering completely, then we must go to a spiritual doctor. Spiritual doctor will also give us different do's and don'ts. Just as the medical doctor has his books, he has his textbooks from which he will look up and say, okay, for this disease, this medicine. So similarly, the spiritual doctor also has books like this. And he is the topmost spiritual doctor, Rupa Goswami. So he is giving us many do's and don'ts. So we have to follow these do's and don'ts if we want to become cured from the material infection. Because all of us, they may say, well, I'm not infected, I'm okay, I'm happy in this world. No, you cannot be happy so long as you have birth, death, old age and disease. You cannot be happy. You only think you are happy, but that is your illusion. Just like a patient who thinks, well, I don't have the disease. But when they get the blood test done and x-ray and everything, there is disease. So the doctor will tell you, well, actually you are diseased. You may say, no, I'm not diseased. But the fact is you are. There are many diseases which show their symptoms later, or the symptoms are there but we don't understand that these are the symptoms of a disease. So similarly, even though we are diseased in this material world, still we don't realize it. And therefore, in our ignorance, we think that actually I am quite all right, I am very happy, but that is not the case. So therefore, if we want to become cured from this disease, we have to take two types of instructions. So in the Vedic scriptures, the do's are called vidhi. Vidhi means it's a rule. You must do this, you must do this, you must do this. And the don'ts, they are called the nishedh. Nishedh means prohibition. You should not do this, you should not do this, etc. Right? So the vidhi and the nishedh both have to be followed. There are so many vidhis and so many nishedhs in the Vedic scriptures. But our acharyas, like Srila Rupa Goswami, have taken the most relevant rules and prohibitions which are connected to just the growth of your bhakti, not for anything else. Because in the Vedic scriptures, there are so many sections that give you, for example, rules and regulations for worshipping the devis and the devatas, the demigods, for obtaining some material benefit, etc. But the devotional, the bhakti acharyas are not concerned with karma kanda, with material benefits. So they are not interested in giving us rules and prohibitions for getting material happiness in this world. That is not their business. They want to tell us how to progress in our bhakti. So they will only give us rules and prohibitions that are connected to bhakti. So from all the rules and regulations, they have extracted, because they are great scholars, and following in the footsteps of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, following Mahaprabhu's teachings, they have presented these in books such as the Upadeshamrita. Smartavyaha satatam Vishnu vismartavyo na jatuchit sarve vidhi nishedhasyur etayor eva kinkaraha. There is a verse in the Purana which says that all the vidhis and nishedhas, all the rules and prohibitions of the Vedas, which are so many, many Veda vidhis and nishedhas, so all of them are servant of only two, one vidhi, one nishedha. Which is that one vidhi, which is the master of all the other vidhis, right? Vidhi means rule, rules, which means do's. So there is one vidhi, one rule, which is the master of all vidhis. In other words, all the vidhis must be performed for fulfilling that one vidhi. What is that one vidhi?
Always remember Krishna.
Always remember Krishna or Vishnu. Smartavyaha satatam Vishnuho. Satatam means always. Not just when I feel like. When I feel like, I will know. Always remember Krishna. Always remember Lord Vishnu. That is the vidhi. So all vidhis in the Vedas are ultimately servant of this one vidhi. So we must, if you follow this one rule, it means you are following all the other rules, all the other vidhis. And therefore, we have to now consider what is that nishedh. What is that one nishedh, that one prohibition, that is the mother or the master of all the nishedhas in the Vedas?
Never forget Krishna.
So always remember Krishna, never forget Krishna. So one is a vidhi, the other is nishedh. One is the rule, the other is the prohibition. But now I have one question to ask you. Both of them mean the same thing. So why is it said separately?
If you practice the first one, the second one becomes redundant automatically.
Yes, so then why the second one has been said separately? Why something, if it is redundant,
emphasize the first one,
okay. But is it really redundant? It means the same thing.
Because if you start practicing the first one, it becomes so much part of yourself, the whole life. You don't need to have the second one in mind.
Okay, but if that were so, then why is this mentioned in the scriptures? Why does it say vismartavyo na jatuchit, that never forget Lord Krishna?
Maybe when you are graduating from this conditioned environment to that environment, at that time you have to take care of the second one also. But once you have attained that first stage,
yes, but now we are in which stage?
Lower stage.
So therefore there is a very important reason actually why the vidhi and nishedh are mentioned separately, even though they actually in effect mean the same thing. And the reason is this, that this verse is meant for practicing devotees like us who are not perfect. Only by practicing it for many years, for a whole lifetime, then we will become perfect. But right now we are still practicing, we are just beginning our practice of Krishna consciousness. So in the practice of Krishna consciousness, we are not very strong. We are not able to always remember Krishna. And we are often forgetting Krishna. So therefore, we have to design the program of our life, our day-to-day activities, our lifestyle, etc., has to be arranged in such a way that the vidhi will be fulfilled and the nishedh will be fulfilled. So therefore the vidhi that we will always remember Krishna means that we will perform those activities which will help us to remember Krishna. So what does this vidhi of always remembering Krishna imply?
We do all those activities which reminds us about Krishna.
We will perform all those activities which will help us to remember Krishna. Then what about the nishedh? That or never forget Krishna?
We will not do those activities which make us forget Krishna.
Absolutely. Don't do those activities which will make you forget Krishna. Right? So let's come back to the example of the doctor. Suppose the doctor is giving you medicine. He's saying, you take this, you take this, you take this. But also don't eat this, don't eat that. If you start eating all of this, the medicine will take very long time to take effect. In fact, you will go again, you will fall sick. So don't do that. So you say that, no, I will only take the medicine. I will not worry about the prohibition. I will keep taking the medicine, but I will not worry about the prohibition. Then what will happen? Will you recover? Not recover. So similarly, even though those two, the vidhi and nishedh, mean the same thing, they are actually different because it reflects the kind of activities we have to do. So suppose you take, that will come in the third verse, those activities that help you remember Krishna, like chanting Hare Krishna, reading Bhagavatam, etc. But then you go and do so many other activities which harm your bhakti. So to stop you from doing those activities, that vidhi, that nishedh has been put there. Right? So those nishedh, that nishedh is also very important. There is a very important purpose for that nishedh to be there. Otherwise it would not be there. Suppose you are cooking. You want to cook. Now you need fire to cook. So you light the fire. You have your vessel ready, everything, ingredients are ready, everything is ready. You come to the stove, you light the fire, then you put some water on the fire. Then again you light the fire, again put water on the fire. And you keep on doing this. So somebody who is hungry waiting for the food will say, what are you doing? He said, I'm cooking the food. So cooking, you're lighting the fire, but then you're putting off the fire. So in the same way, if you want to do bhakti, then you do those activities which are favorable, but at the same time you also do those activities which are harmful. So what is the meaning of that? It's like taking all the medicines given by the doctor, but also continuing to eat all the foods that he has prohibited. So therefore both have to be separately mentioned. So vidhi, the vidhi of smartavya satatam Vishnu, always remember Vishnu or Krishna, means do all those things that are helpful to remember Krishna. And the nishedh, never forget Krishna, means don't perform those activities which will make you forget Krishna. So that nishedh is now being explained in this verse. Verse number 2. So all these six factors, shadbhir bhaktir vinashyati, it means that if you do these six things, your bhakti will be destroyed. So don't do these six things. That is a nishedh or a prohibition. Right? So this is the background of it. We are very clear about it?
Yes, Maharaj.
Okay, now I want somebody to explain what I have said in 2 minutes only. You have to all become teachers. You have to learn and you have to teach others. So when you go, then you should go out and you should tell somebody what you have learned. So this whole principle of vidhi and nishedh, I would like somebody to explain. Actually, I would like 2-3 devotees to explain. And we will give you some special prasad after that. During. Okay, so who volunteers? Yes. in only 2 minutes, and the vidhi and nishedh.
So just the way the doctor is prescribing the patient.
Can closer.
The doctor is prescribing patient the medicine to cure the disease, and he takes a medicine, but also does not follow the other rule, which has meant there has been some prohibitions.
Hmm.
So he's doing eating things which he's not supposed to eat. Then his disease never get cured.
Hmm.
So in the same way, in our spiritual practices, we need to follow things that are favorable, that are helpful to grow in spiritual life. And if we, at the same time, if we carry on doing things we should not do, then that will not help. So that's
what will happen?
We will never achieve the goal that we want to achieve.
What is the last line here? Shadbhir bhakti vinashyati. Our bhakti will be destroyed. Okay, excellent. Somebody else? Vidhi and nishedh.
So, if you don't take what the doctor has, such as the medicine, if you don't take it, you'll just stay ill. It's such as if you don't do all these spiritual activities, you are not able to go to the spiritual world and be spiritual.
Excellent. But I also want to know about the 2 kinds of things that the doctor says.
And also, the doctor will also say what you don't. If you, such as, all these. It's raw meat, that's bad stuff. When you're trying to be spiritual, you don't do stuff that doesn't make you spiritual.
Okay.
Just stop yourself.
Okay, excellent. You will get double Mahaprasadam. Okay, in 2 minutes, explain the vidhi and nishedh, the rule and the prohibition.
So, take the example of fire and water. And suppose bhakti, the Krishna consciousness, is the fire. And you are constantly doing bad things and you're putting out that fire, because then the bad things are like putting the... You're doing the bhakti as well, but at the same time you're doing the bad things. So it's basically like you're starting the whole thing again.
Lighting the fire, putting it off. Okay, very nice, very good. Somebody else who will explain? Vidhi and Nishedh with the 2 examples. Yes. What is vidhi? What is nishedh? The example of the doctor and example of, and then coming to bhakti.
When we go to a doctor, he suggests 2 things. One, the prescription, the do's and don'ts, what we should do and what we should not do. Similarly, in scriptures, to attain the goal of so that's why in scriptures they have suggested 2 things. One is the do's, what we should do in the spiritual life and what we should not do.
What are they called? What are they called?
Yeah, whatever we should do, it is called as vidhi, and whatever we should not do is called as nishir. And second analogy that we gave is of fire. If a person is lighting fire and again putting water on it, then it will be just futile. So similarly, there are nishir, which is we should not do, so that we can always remember Krishna. And obviously, if you follow these 2 things, then you'll be able to do our bhakti properly.
Okay, very nice. Excellent. You will also get some prasadam. Now, 1 point I would like you all to explain is, from the point of view of always remembering Krishna, never forgetting Krishna, the vidhi and nishedh. Who will explain that? Yes, somebody else has to do. Anybody?
I'll try to do that.
Okay.
Maharaj, first of all, you said that there is one foremost principle, which is always remember Krishna and never forget him. And then you explain the reason why these two have to be mentioned simultaneously, because they can mean one and the same thing.
But still they are mentioned separately.
Yes. But the importance when you mentioned is the vidhi, which are the things which we should do to progress in bhakti. And then at the same time, there are certain domes which we should avoid, which are called nishet. And if we do this together, only then we can progress in bhakti. So if we continue doing the nishet at the same time, then it's useless, basically.
Yes, what will happen?
Bhakti will be destroyed.
Bhakti vinashyati. So bhakti becomes destroyed.
That is also... one can also understand, you know, like you said, the beginners like us, who, you know, just the beginning of the stage. So it's easy to remember what people say, can you do this? So you tend to do that and copy that to some degree. So say, chant, and you start chanting, you say, you know, do this, you start doing. And you often don't realize what else you must not do to take it effect. When it will work. So I think the other verse, you know, the second nishes part is reminding us that it's equally important things you must not do. And if you remember both at the same time, then the progression can be much quicker. Because it's human nature to remember things we are told to do, but we easily forget what people don't tell us. We even forget what people tell us, but if we don't tell, then it's, I think, that's why it's specifically mentioned that these are don'ts, and to see its effect,
very nice, very good. And also it is significant that the nishedhas are coming first, verse yes. number 2. The vidhi will come in the third verse. So the nishedh is so important that Srila Rupa Goswami has mentioned it even before mentioning those activities that are favorable. Yeah.
Hmm? So Maharaji, it's also like automatic. If we start following nishedh, so eventually we will get to do those things which are preferable.
Maybe, maybe not.
We still have to know them.
Your question is that if you simply do nishedh, like for example the doctor says, I'll give you these medicines, but also don't eat fried things, don't eat sour things. So what do? You don't take the medicines, but you just avoid the sour things, avoid the fried things. So will you become all right? So both have to be done, the vidhi as well as the nishet. Both must be done for complete recovery.
Yeah, we are conditioned souls, so we need that antibiotic to work. So as a medicine, and on top then we need parahij.
Yes, yes. And what is important also is that as you do the nishedh, all you are doing, so the nishedh is generally not a medical thing for a doctor. The medicine is a medical thing, but the nishedh is usually just avoid something. So similarly, when we say, I'm following the nishedh for my bhakti, for my progress of bhakti, the nishedh is not something spiritual. I'm not eating meat. It's not a great thing. Nowadays it is great, but from point of view of bhakti, it is not something spiritual. I don't take alcohol. By not taking alcohol, I don't become a spiritual person. By not taking meat, I don't become a spiritual person. By not gambling, I don't become a spiritual person. But if I do those things, then my spirituality will be destroyed. You get the point? So therefore, just merely following the nishedh also will not make you a bhakta or a devotee of Krishna. There are many vegetarians. They are not devotees. There are many people who don't drink alcohol. They are not devotees. Right? So therefore, we cannot do one of the two. We have to do both. Only when you do both, then you will actually succeed. So the vidhi are actually the spiritual activities in bhakti. The bhakti activities are actually the vidhi. They are actually very important because they will give you the bhakti. But the importance of the nishedha is that if you don't follow that, they will spoil what you are doing here. They will destroy this. You get the point? So the nishedha, the activities that are forbidden are not, by following that, you are not doing anything spiritual. You are just preventing your spiritual life from getting spoiled. That's all. So you are only preventing that. But the actual spiritual activities, the bhakti activities, will come in the third verse, which is what you should be doing, chanting, etc. Alright? So, we follow vidhi or nishedha, which one?
Both.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Convinced?
Yes.
Okay. So, what are these two? The nishedha now that is mentioned here. First one is atyahar. We'll be very brief because otherwise if you go to describe in detail, it will take too long. And if you read this purport, it is very simple. Srila Prabhupada has explained every one of those six items in such a simple, clear manner with nice examples. So you will not have any difficulty understanding what these six prohibitions or nishedhas are. Okay? But just briefly we will run through it. It was important to give this whole background of the vidhi and nishedh in order to understand verse number 2 and the next one, which is verse number 3. So of the nishedh, the first one is ati ahar. Ahar generally means food, but it can also mean wealth. Ati ahar means eating more than you need to eat and collecting more money than you need to collect. Srila Prabhupada gives very nice examples here, especially of grains. When you put out a bag of grains outside, maybe it won't happen here in England, but in India definitely it will happen. You put a bag of grains outside, when the birds come, they eat a few grains and they go away. But when a human being comes, what happens? He will look here, he will look there, he will see nobody is there, okay, pick up the whole thing and go away. And he will stock it for many days. But the birds will come and eat and go away. When the stomach is full, they go away. So the birds are living a very simple life. But human beings, our life is very complicated because we want to store for a long time. So we should not collect more funds than necessary. We should not be eager for that. And we should not eat also more than necessary. What is more than necessary? What is the meaning of necessary here? Is it the same standard for all of us?
No.
Why not?
Because we all have different appetites. And also in terms of wealth, we have taken birth in a different standard of families, and our requirements are different. So.
Okay, even in terms of body, suppose Bhima was here, Bhimsen, and you tell him you have to eat like us, will that do?
No.
If you do work like Bhim, then you eat like Bhim. If you want to serve Krishna like Bhima and Hanuman, you eat. But if you're going to be not very active, then eat less. So when it says necessary, it means necessary for your bhakti. Not just for keeping body and soul together. Generally people understand when you say that you should eat what is necessary, collect whatever is necessary only. What is the meaning of necessary? Necessary means not just to keep body and soul together and survive. What it means is what is necessary for your bhakti. If for your bhakti you need more money, collect it. You want to go to Vrindavan once a year, you want to travel to see the holy places, you need money.
Yes.
Then you can't say, well, I have not, now I don't have money, then what to do? So you have to be realistic and practical about the modern day life that you're leading. At the same time, you know, don't overdo it and just collect so much money, then you will get attached to that money. So that is ati ahar. That should not be done. The second is prayas. Actually, the word ati applies to prayas also. Prayas means effort, some activity or effort. But the word in this context means ati prayas, means over endeavoring for some material goals. I want to be a very big person in this world. I want to do this, I want to do that. I want to have this, I want to have so much. Then we become too ambitious in this world. That is also not good. That will also destroy our spiritual life. Prabhupada speaks about simple living and high thinking. Very nice essay, very brief essay on simple living, high thinking as part of this purport. Because the ultimate goal of life is to be Krishna conscious, not simply to just accumulate so many things in this world, right? What is the third thing, the third nishedh? Atyahara prayasascha prajalpaha. Prajalpaha means in this context, what kind of talk? Mundane talk, materialistic talk, gossiping. Any talk that has no benefit for your spiritual life. Not just that you should not criticize others and talk ill about others, not only that, but even talking other things that have no value for your spiritual life. There are so many things in the world that are people talk about generally, so which have no importance for spiritual life. So in the Bhagavatam also, it has been explained. Ranam santi sahasrashah apashyatam atma tattvam griheshu grihamedinam. So there are hundreds of topics that people have in this world, mundane topics to talk about. You know, sports, politics, economics, social things. You know, what is happening in this house, what is happening in that house. So many topics people have. But people who do not know the real interest of their life, that it is Atma Tattva, self-realization, they indulge in such materialistic talks. But actually the serious devotee will not engage in such gossip. What is the next one? Niyamagraha. Now Niyama means there are different rules. Yes, we follow different rules and injunctions given in the scriptures. Now this niyam agraha, do you have some chart or paper or a pad? So this niyam agraha, it consists of two words. Which are the two words? And anything else? Agraha. Yes. Niyam and agraha. So this, the second word can either be agraha or it can be agraha, which means the opposite of agraha. You just add an a sometimes and then we get the opposite meaning. Agraha means the opposite as agraha. Okay. So the word, when you combine the two words together, it is, how do you pronounce it?
Niyamagraha.
Don't split it, don't say niyam and then agra, say niyamagraha.
Niyamagraha.
It is one continuous word as written in the scriptures. So those of you who read Devanagari, you look at the verse, the Devanagari verse, yes? Is it one word? Yes? Niyamagraha is one verse. Okay? Okay. who would like to write this Niyamagraha in English as well as in Devanagari? I know some of you may not follow Devanagari, but we'll do both in English and... with all the bars and dots and dashes. Right. Okay. I think I will do it.
Sorry.
Okay. Can you give there?
Yes.
Just write. Very simply, we'll write. Okay, can you turn?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now you can put the diacritic marks on the English.
Yes, ma'am.
And the dot below the H. Yes, you can see here.
Yes, ma'am. Hmm?
You put?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now how do you split up? What are the two words here?
Niyam and Agraha.
So can you write?
Yeah, okay. English
one
is okay.
Both. I also want to give a little lesson in pronunciation. Because even devotees from India pronounce wrongly. Huh?
Yeah, just copy that.
Agraha.
Leave space.
Okay. And what is the other possibility?
Agraha. No A, right?
Niyam.
A space. No.
That A will have the line, the first one, the top one. That will become Agraha.
Okay. Oh, no. Sorry.
No.
I think the Niyam down, that will have A and the upper one will not have A.
No,
see, okay, I will explain. Okay, next. You do next.
Next page, right?
Yeah, you have another page?
Yes.
Okay.
Sheila, just watch.
So it can be Niyam Agraha or Niyam Agraha. And how is it written? The full word is written as Niyam Agraha. How? Because it is not Niyam. There is is there, it is A, why this A, you skip the A here,
yes.
Remember, why is this A important?
It's a complete word.
How do you pronounce this word?
Niyama.
Niyama.
Niyam.
Niyam or Niyama or Niyama?
Niyama.
The M and Ma.
Niyama.
The three things, we must know the distinction between the three. Yes? For example, oh.
Sorry.
Which is correct?
Yeah.
Middle one.
Last one.
How many think first one is correct? How many think second one is correct? How many think third one is correct?
Third one is for English people.
Now how will you write this in English according to the dachshund? Bars.
Somebody
else. According to the dots and dashes and the bars, you write accordingly. What about this?
There should be a dot under it.
No, no. This. What about this long matra here? How will it come there?
Oh.
Excellent. Very good. Okay. So now, which is correct? Which is correct?
In English.
Hmm.
Second.
Yes. Second one is correct. So how will you pronounce, generally how do we pronounce it?
Ram.
If you say Ram, then it is this. But is it correct?
No.
If you say Rama?
No.
No. So how will you pronounce it in between this and this? What is the pronunciation?
Rama.
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 Rama. Okay. Actually, this is... You get it? Oops. Hmm?
This we learned in the basic in the schools in India.
Yes. And that is how I'm having to teach it now.
The line under ma, what does that mean?
Ma, it is a stop. You see this ma?
Ma.
It's a ma plus a. All vowels, all alphabets, they have the a in it.
Yeah.
When you take away the a, it just becomes this.
Ma. Ma. Otherwise it's ma.
Mm.
Ma. There's a in it.
Mm. Not a.
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 So Ram.
Ram.
Or Ram.
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 Ram. Is it Ram? Ram. Ram, then it should be written like this.
Ram. Yes.
But do we write it like this?
No.
Do we write it like this?
Yes.
Yes. So then you have to see the long A. Rama.
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 Rama. Rama. Rama. Hare Hare. Not Ram Ram Hare Hare. Rama Rama. The correct thing is Rama Rama Hare Hare. Okay?
So then in English it should not be said as Rama. People say wherever there's A in the English, it comes, they pronounce it as long A. It should not be.
No, we should know where is the long A, where is the short A.
But in this case, in the middle one, people would say Rama.
No, it's not Rama.
It's Ram.
Yeah. It is Ram.
Ram.
Rama. Neither Ram nor Rama.
So it's not
that people say Hare Rama wale aaye hain. They say like that. Hare Krishna, Hare Rama. They say like that. But it is Krishna, Rama. Strictly speaking. Okay? That is clear? Now, same thing apply here. Niyam? Is it this ma?
Krishna.
Or which ma is it?
Middle one.
So how will you pronounce it?
Niyam.
So is there an a in that or not?
Yes.
So there is an a. So there is this plus this. That is this. So there is already an a here. So a and a combined becomes
a.
A. So niyam agraha. And here there is a. So a plus a becomes
a.
A. Still the same. A. So therefore your word is niyam agraha. So it can be either niyama and agraha or niyama and agraha. Clear?
Yes.
That is why both possibilities are there. This is how the word Sanskrit is written and read also. Okay, so just remember this as far as when you read the verses. If you are reading in Devanagari, it's fine, you will see it as it is. If you are reading in English script, you keep in mind the dots and the dashes and the bars. That will give you the correct pronunciation. Generally, people make the big mistake of making the short vowel into a long vowel, the long vowel into a short vowel. Ramyan, they say Ramyan, many people say Ramyan. Right? Because you confuse the long and the short vowels.
One question, Maharaj. Normally when we see people reading English, they would say Arjun as Arjuna, Duryodhan as Duryodhana. So it's the middle one that
yes.
We just say but it's not A, it's Duryodhan as we say in Hindi.
In Hindi, we say everything like this.
Yes.
The Hindi pronunciation is like this, but in Sanskrit it is incorrect. You have to say this.
Duryodhana. But it's not A. The way this.
It is not like this.
Single.
It is not this. Okay. So therefore, niyama agraha, niyama agraha. So pronunciation, we must be very careful. Okay, we mispronounce only because, mostly because of inattentiveness. We don't read the marks, diacritic marks, the long A, the short A, we interchange according to whatever comes to our mind. For Bhakti Charu Maharaj, they say Bhakti Chiru Swami, Chiru. They say Chiru, it's not, it's Bhakti Charu Swami. It's Charu, right? Right? Radharani, Radha, it's not Radha, it's Radharani. Okay, so the emphasis on the correct vowel is very important. So, agraha means to be very eager to do something. So very eagerly, being very particular about following all the rules and regulations, very strictly, every little thing. But not knowing why. Why am I following all these rules and regulations? We don't know. We are following, perfect. Every little rule and regulation we follow. But we don't know why. On the other hand, niyam agraha means the opposite. We don't follow anything. Why should I follow any rules and regulations? Lord is in my heart. Yes? So that is unfavorable for bhakti. Both are unfavorable for bhakti. Niyama agraha and niyama agraha. Okay? Alright, so quickly we'll finish the other two. Then the next one is janasangaha. What is the meaning of janasangaha here? Jan means people. But in this context, what does it mean?
Worldly-minded
people. So when you associate with worldly-minded people, your bhakti will be destroyed. Why will it be destroyed? Yeah, so what happens with wrong association? You get influenced by that. You want to become like them. Whatever they are saying, you become like them. There's a saying, isn't it, in Hindi, jaisa sang vaisa rang.
Yes,
so according to what you associate with, you get that kind of quality.
Yes.
So if you're associating with people who are very worldly minded, then you also become worldly minded. So we are going to see in the next verse, when you study that, you will see how associating with devotees is the vidhi. But the corresponding nished is?
Don't associate with worldly minded people.
Both things are essential. If you're associating with devotees and at the same time also associating with worldly minded people, what will happen? It's counterproductive. You're getting the benefit of bhakti, but because you're going to the worldly minded people too much, so that consciousness comes into you and gradually you will not be able to associate with devotees also. You will start thinking, oh, I'm not interested anymore. Your enthusiasm for associating with devotees will come down. And for devotional service, that is what will happen. Laulyam. What is laulyam?
Greed.
Greed for what?
For mundane.
For anything mundane, which is more or less similar. So one should not be similar to prayas, but here greedy is just simply want more money, more this, more that. One understands what is greedy. And shadbhir bhakti vinashyati. So I would request you to please read the purport. It is very, very nice. Prabhupada's purports are so eloquent and so lucid and clear. It is a great boon for us to have Srila Prabhupada's explanations, which will help us to understand these important verses nicely. So these six things are harmful for our bhakti, for our Krishna consciousness. So we should be very careful to avoid these six things. Okay? What is the time now? 8:45. Okay. So all right, thank you very much for coming, and Devesh, Vindarika, Sridhama, thank you very much for your hospitality, and I thank all of you also for having come today and participated in the Sangha. I would like to wish all of you all happy progress in your Krishna consciousness.
Thank you. Thank
you. And you have your group, you meet together?
Yes, Father.
Regular. It's a very nice thing. You are meeting here, you meet in different houses each time?
Yes,
or here?
Sometimes we go and meet in Vishnu's house, Aniket Prabhu's house.
So it's very nice, this idea of all of you meeting together and learning about Krishna consciousness. I applaud your efforts. And please continue. Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.